wishing you were a banner strand, holding your nephew's hands. We walked along the waterfront, up Bunker, down on Main. We met at the monument, where everyone knew our names. Our first kiss on 40 flights, our friends on the stoop on summer nights. The church door was always open as the bells rang out for you and me, for all to see on our wedding day. There's an immigrant soul under Southern stars and me.
Good evening and welcome to Charlestown Live. I'm Tom Coots and I'm your host for this evening's show. Before we begin, we'd like to, as we always do, thank our partner, Charlestown Against Drugs, and our sponsor, Partners Healthcare, which includes the following: MGH Charlestown Healthcare Center, MGH Institute of Health Professionals, Spalding Rehabilitation Hospital, and the MGH Sharps Program. Without their generous support, we couldn't bring the show to you this evening. And speaking of Spalding Rehabilitation Hospital, next week at the Whole Foods in Charlestown, they'll be doing their 5% back to a local nonprofit. And this month, it's going to go to Spalding Rehabilitation Hospital. So if you need to get your grocery shopping done, get out to Whole Foods and earn some money that will go back to Spalding, who in turn do an awful lot for our community. Well, many of you know that today is September 11th, and we are 13 years past that fateful day of the World Trade Center coming down. So as we're thinking back about what took place that day and where we were, one of the things I'd like to encourage all of you to do as you're remembering those who were killed that day is to remember the first responders who went into those buildings while others were running out. So if you see a firefighter or a police officer or EMT or a soldier, just thank them for what they've done for us in their service. They do what a lot of us can't do, so we thank them. And so I personally want to thank them this evening on September 11th. Well, this evening I have my guest tonight is David Hennessy, who is Vice President of the Charlestown Historical Society. And we're going to be talking about the Charlestown State Prison. But before we begin, I just want to remind you that this is a live call-in show, and you can call us at 617-708-3290. So if you have any questions for me or for David or about the show, feel free to do so. So welcome to the show, David.
Hi, I'm glad to be here.
Thank you. I appreciate it, too. You and I both are with the Charlestown Historical Society, and we work on a lot of programs together. One of the programs that you have done a few times in Charlestown is on the Charlestown State Prison. It's always a really popular one, and I thought it'd be great to bring here tonight. So Charlestown had a prison. When was this prison around, and for how long?
Well, the prison was built in 1805, okay. And the prison was there for 150 years until 1955. Prior to that, the state prison was actually at Castle Rock,
okay.
And it was there for about 15 years, but that's not really a good place for a prison. They wanted a prison that could keep people in.
Well, isn't down at Castle Light, isn't that a fortress?
Yeah, meant there? To keep people out.
Okay, yeah, so yeah, I suppose that wouldn't work. So they built the prison in Charleston in 1805,
mm-hmm.
And it was there till 1955, so it was there for a while. Where exactly in Charleston was it?
The prison was approximately where the Bunker Hill Community College is now.
Okay.
And it turned out that Charlestown was a pretty interesting choice for a prison. At the time, it was still its own city. It wasn't part of Boston.
Okay.
It was an island, and it only had one bridge off the island, so it made it easier to catch anyone who might try to leave. And you also had close by the Cambridge police and the Boston police and the military that were down in at the Navy Yard. So.
Okay. Well, that answers that answer to that question answers another question. Now I know why the Gilmore Bridge to the people in Charleston have always been called Prison Point Bridge,
yep.
Because obviously it went right on top. So I've heard stories that guards actually patrolled the bridge to make sure that no one dropped any ropes down to help anyone escape.
That's right. The other interesting thing that most people don't know about the prison is The prison is approximately where the Middlesex Canal began and went all the way up to the Middlesex River, and then from the Middlesex River you could get all the way up into Concord, New Hampshire.
And on the other side is also the railroad.
The railroad, right. But the canal came first. The canal came in 1803. Railroads didn't really start arriving until around 1830s, 1840s.
So it made it really good to get supplies in and out, and I also suppose might be a good way to get prisoners in and out too.
Yeah,
so
could be.
Without it. All right, that's great. So walk me through what the daily life would be for one of the prisoners.
Yeah, the prisoner's daily life was pretty straightforward, and it was pretty much the same every day except Sunday. And what it included is 6 hours of work, so they would work making products, mm-hmm. And include 45 minutes in the yard where they could walk around, talk to people, 15 minutes where they would take their slop bucket from their prison cell and take it to a place where it could be emptied. And then the other 17 hours were spent by themselves in the cell.
So not much changed in the 150 years. It was, you know, things may have changed in it, but the process was pretty much the same.
Pretty much the same. And in fact, the prison was actually condemned a number of times during that 150-year period because it was pretty archaic in the 1950s to not have any indoor plumbing.
Well, the slop bucket in 1950s was horrible.
Yeah, and to make it even worse is they didn't have any cafeterias, so you had to go get your food and bring it back
and eat it in the cell. Okay. We've got a caller. Hello, caller.
Hi there, Tom. This is Jean Tochterman.
Hi, Jean.
I got a couple of points of information on this. This is one of my favorite subjects. When you'd walk by the Prison Point Bridge, we walked everywhere, you'd see the guards up on the abutments with their rifles. And I got to tell you, you walked past there quick because it made you nervous, you know. And then during the winter, they would bring out details of trustees, and they would shovel out the intersections and, like, Monument Avenue, you know, from one side of the foot of the hill to the other, and they would do that. And then they had the electric chair. And when they had, would put someone to death, all the lights would go blinking in Charlestown, and my dad would turn to my mother and said, "Well, Grace, there goes another one." So that's some of the stories I have, and I'm going to sign off now and just listen to the rest of this. It's so interesting. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jean. Okay. I appreciate you calling in.
Bye-bye.
All right. Take care. And I'm sure there's got a lot more people that have a lot of stories like that, that they remember a number of things. I've heard some of the older people in Charlestown say that, they remember the lights in their kitchen dimming, and they knew exactly what was happening.
Yeah, I think a lot of people would be surprised at how the electric chair actually got built. It was actually built in 1899 by the prisoners, so they got to build the chair themselves.
All right, so we have a photo up on the screen. So that's the chair, the electric chair that was built for the Charlestown Prison. So the prisoners built this knowing that one day they may be sitting in the seat.
That was a definite possibility.
That's kind of creepy. That really is. So we were talking about the daily life of the prisoners. Now, we all know, or at least we've all heard the stories that, you know, when they're in prison, they make ashtrays and license plates. What would they have been doing during their 6 hours of work?
Yeah, in the 1800s, for most of that time, they would be making products that could be sold. So they made buggy whips. In fact, we have a slide showing the buggy whips. They would also make chains. They would also make, after 1888, it was outlawed to make products that could be sold. So after that, they had to make products that the state would use. And we see in the next slide where they were making license plates that you referred to. Okay. Those are stacks of license plates.
Okay. So they really did make the license plates. That's not just a folklore.
Yeah, no. They made a bunch of other things. They made gloves, clothes, underwear, hats, pretty much anything that somebody in the state system, whether it be hospitals or prisons or education, could use.
Okay. Well, the prison was there for 150 years, and during that time period, I'm sure there were some notable individuals who graced the doorsteps of the Charlestown State Prison. Mm-hmm. Anyone in particular that
Yeah, the prison, the prison was an important part of Charlestown because it employed a lot of people, and it was pretty hard to miss. It was the single biggest structure in the town. And they had a lot of interesting people there. The most famous is probably Sacco and Vanzetti. Most people know the story about Sacco and Vanzetti. They were accused in 1921 of robbing the payroll for a particular business. Mm-hmm. They were found guilty, although the public and many other people believe that they were in fact not guilty, but they were found guilty. And even up to the last minute, there was another prisoner who belonged to an Italian gang who admitted that he took part in the robbery and that they did not take part in the robbery. For that, he got to spend the final day with them, where all three were executed on one day.
Misery loves company.
Yes.
Well, I think, you know, when you talk about Sacco and Vanzetti, everyone, well, at least in my generation, we learned about it in school, but we don't learn so much about robbing the payroll or being in the Charlestown prison, but the fact that they were anarchists.
Correct, correct.
And were they used as a scapegoat, maybe, or?
Yeah, I think it was a period where they were used as a scapegoat. And there was the anarchist part of it, and there was also the anti-Italian part of it.
Okay.
So I think both of those counted against them.
So what time period was this that they were there?
They were there. They were found. The robbery took place, I believe, in 1921,
okay.
And they were executed in 1927.
Okay. So they were there. So they were there for a little while before they departed.
Right. Now, another very interesting character that most people won't know about, I actually had to think about it myself for a second, is Ted Green. Ted Green was a Greek fellow who was, you know, born in the early 1920s, went to prison for the first time in 1947, and his profession was bank robberies.
Okay.
He did 20 or 21 bank robberies. He spent about 20 years in prison for those robberies. And then while he was in prison, he attempted to escape approximately 40 times. So he was known for his stick-to-itiveness on the escape path.
40 times in 20 years.
Yeah.
So twice a year, take a little vacation from work.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, one of the times he worked in the glove shop where they made gloves, leather gloves, and the remnants would be put in this box, and you know, once a week a truck would come and they'd pick up the box and recycle the remnants. So he got in this box, he arranged for a friend to follow the truck to pick him up later. Unfortunately, on that day, they had two boxes and two trucks, and his friend followed the wrong box. So he's ended up spending the night back in prison.
So this wasn't just climb over the wall like you see and then run, try not to get in the spotlight.
Yeah.
He came up with some creative ways to escape.
He did a few of the climb over the wall thing. One time it was him and three other guys, and they had a hook that they had made out of some metal. But unfortunately, when they got on the rope, the hook sort of straightened out, and they ended back.
Now I heard there was another story. I heard. Pertaining to him, I believe, was that he tried to get out through the septic system.
Yeah, there was an attempt to get out through the septic system, which was successful. I think six or seven people escaped, and there are records of two or three of those being captured, but other ones never being captured.
And that's a little creepy.
Shawshank Redemption reminds
you. You must really need to get out of there if you want to go out through the septic system. That's terrible. So so the Charlestown prison was there for under 50 years. It must have employed a lot of people from the community.
Mm-hmm.
So it was even though you look at a prison as being an unwanted place in the community, but it had to have been a source of income for many people as well.
Yeah, it was a source of income, plus they bought a lot of products there, but the biggest was the employment there.
Bought a lot of products. You'd go down to the prison to buy things?
No. The prison itself would have to buy bread.
So they were a consumer of the okay, so that makes perfect sense. We talked a little bit about the electric chair early on. It was built by the prisoners. Up until the point that the electric chair was created, the way of execution was hanging.
Correct.
So in 1805, when the prison was begun, opened, they had done hanging there.
Mm-hmm.
but when the electric chair came in, is this the first electric chair in the country or
I'm not sure. I don't think it was the first in the country. I think it was New York had the first in the country. And the guy who actually designed the New York electric chair also designed the Charlestown electric chair, although it's not that complicated.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if it had to be put together by the inmates, it couldn't be that difficult.
Yeah.
You know, just find that strange. But so what happened after the prison closed? What did they do with the electric chair?
The last execution was in 1947. Then the electric chair was sent off to Walpole.
Okay.
It wasn't clear whether it would be used again, but the prisoners actually found the electric chair and where it was stored, and they destroyed it. So the chair was created by the prisoners, and it was destroyed by the prisoners.
Well, that makes sense. That would make a lot of sense. When we talked about Sacco and Vanzetti, we talked about Teddy Green. Someone else that was there, and I know we weren't going to talk about it, but it just came into my mind. Malcolm X was there for a short period of time.
Yeah, he was. He was there for a short period of time. I think he was found guilty of a robbery and went there, but I think he was there for less than 2 years.
But he wasn't Malcolm X then. He went by
his regular name.
Yeah. So there have been a number of famous individuals there.
Yeah.
When we were talking earlier, you had mentioned how today you have a minimum security, you have maximum security, but back in these days, it was one prison for the worst of the worst and the best, least of the worst, but they divided them into different sections.
Yeah, and the prison had a number of additions over the years. When it was built, it was only built for 90 prisoners. The last addition was in 1923, where it was up to 750 prisoners.
Wow.
That it could house. And the last addition was called Cherry Hill. And the Cherry Hill addition was made so that people would be in there all the time, solitary confinement, which meant that they did have plumbing in Cherry Hill, but they didn't get to socialize much. And when the guards went into the Cherry Hill section, they didn't carry keys or guns or anything. So if they were overwhelmed by the prisoners, they could have gotten out. So it was considered the worst but the best place in the prison to be. And that's where the final riots happened in 1955, that the state finally decided they had to close the prison.
Okay. So the worst criminals, the most vilest offenders, go into the Cherry Hill section. But they get the plumbing, the rest of the, so even in 1955, and this, I just keep coming back to this, in 1955, the inmates in the regular part of the prison still had to take their own slop buckets out and empty them, and where they ate was the same place as where they used their restroom facilities.
Yep.
So was there any board of overseers or anyone from the state that came in? And
there was an annual report that the prison had to submit every year, and then there were these ad hoc groups that would actually come in and do an evaluation. Not sure how independent those groups were.
Okay. So, wow. Now, you said they got shut down for a couple of years?
Yeah, they got shut down in the late 1800s. And they were shut down like for 3 or 4 years. The people in the prison at that time went to Concord, the Concord prison, but then there was overcrowding in the system and they opened the prison back up and put the worst prisoners back in Charlestown.
So it wasn't during that 3 year period, they said, okay, let's do a renovation, let's make this a lot better. They just said, look, this place isn't working. They moved them out, but then they just moved them right back into the same
situation. Yeah, they had a crew go in and literally paint everything white and...
That always helps. Paint it white and it looks like it'll be brand new.
The inside.
So tell us some other things that you found out about the Charlestown prison that most people wouldn't know about.
Well, they had the clergy involved with the church, and there was always someone there from the clergy, but it changed as the population changed.
Mm.
So, in certain periods, it would have been Protestant because you would probably have English people who were going to prison, and then it was Irish, so then you would have Catholics, and Italians, you would have Catholics, and then you know, you might have Presbyterians. So that changed during the years of the prison. I think that was one thing that was interesting to me. I think the other thing that was interesting is that even when the railroads finally did come in, the prison always was close to a major transportation route to bring things out in or let things go out. In the early days, the prison was actually paid for itself. So they made enough money making buggy whips that they actually paid for the, you know, all the guards.
It was self-sufficient.
It was self-sufficient, yeah.
Now, one of the things that we discussed before the show started was that it was a debtor's prison as well. So not just you know, rob a bank or you kill someone, but if you couldn't pay your debts, they put you in prison.
Yeah, and that's true in the early period. They were, if you didn't pay your debts, you could end up in the prison, and until somebody in your family or friends paid the debt, you stayed there.
Wow.
But later on, it was more about murders and robberies and less about debtors.
Well, in that case, you hope you had a really good family system to support you. Well, we're just about out of time, but if you're interested in more about the Charlestown State Prison or any of the programs for the Charlestown Historical Society, there are a couple of different ways. You can get on the website, which is www.charlestownhistoricalsociety.org, or you can come to one of the programs coming up in the fall sessions. Really quickly, give us a couple of the topics that we're coming up in the fall.
Yeah, in the fall, we're going to have a walking tour of Charlestown. We're also going to have a talk by the Boston archaeologist about...
Joe Bagley,
about the coastline of Charlestown. And we also have the talk about the pistol.
The pistol, yes. Great story that will be coming up later on. A young man from Charlestown, as he's going to fight in the Civil War, P. Marion Holmes, he's given a great Civil War pistol as he goes in, and we have this pistol in our collection, so we'll be doing some talks. Well, David, thank you for coming on. We'll have you come back again. I know you have in the past done a great program on John Boyle O'Reilly, and we'll hope to get you back to that again. Thank you for tuning in tonight. Again, we want to thank Chad, Charlestown Against Drugs, our sponsor, and Partners Healthcare. We'll see you again very soon here on Charlestown Live. And as always, I remain yours, Charlestown. Good night.
Remember Charlestown, now and forever. God bless Charlestown. Good night.